is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Saturday, broadcasting from Nassau, Bahamas, and streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com, the country's news talk radio station with fresh news and smart talk all day. The lineup begins with The Eye Opener with Don Sargent and Tate Adderley live at 9 a.m. That's followed by Influencers with Lady Shima at 11 a.m. Next comes Candid with Anise Bell and Janae Forbes at noon. And then University Drive from the University of the Bahamas at 1 p.m. That's all straight ahead, beginning with The Eye Opener next here on Guardian Radio 96.9 Saturday.
Welcome to The Eye Opener, your weekly dose of something absolutely different. I'm your host, Don Sargent. Joining me in studio is Tate Adderley.
How are you doing today, Don?
I'm doing excellent, Tate. How are you?
I'm doing okay.
You look tired, Tate. You've been out drinking!
No, I haven't drank in like, I think about...
Oh, you're off the sauce.
Off the sauce right now. This week was a very stressful week for me. I don't remember much of it. I'm just trying to get work done and help graduate from the University of Bahamas.
Listen to him. You want to get out of here and finish.
Yeah. It's been 5 years. You know, I remember my first time on this show was in September of 2017. It's been like going on 5 years now since I've been on this show. And so...
Wow!
Every time I think about you, me, it's always synonymous with the beginning of this show.
Take you away,
this show. Yeah, 22. I started this when I was 17, eh?
You'll be retired in a couple of years when you stop paying your
pension. That's what I mean.
This has been a week, Tate. Everything from the threats of power, of electricity prices going up for the fuel surcharge and the kilowatt hour prices and...
What was all that about? Because I was listening to one show, I think it was on Thursday or Wednesday, and he was talking about how I guess the procedure was wrong, the cabinet having the right to decision over the fuel charge, and then the mix-up about Mr. Heastie.
What do you mean they were wrong? What do you mean?
It seemed as though that cabinet shouldn't have any purview over the decision about the fuel charge. That's the impression that I got from
that's
the
show. That's Mr. McCartney said?
That's the impression that I got.
Wow! That's crazy. I mean, that could be his opinion. That's fair. Yeah. It could be a valid opinion. I just would like to say, this is the Bahamas. Cabinet or the second coming of Christ. And once you get that through your head, then you understand that everything is their purview when it's convenient. Yeah. Right? Yeah.
It's the impression that I also got was that the whole procedure around deciding that was a bit wonky. And then there was this guy who called into the show who was kind of like trying to, and he was a PLP supporter, of course. He was trying to basically railroad this show and I guess mix up the conversation. So that was that whole part of that. But
of that's course, just one of the of things. Of course, they like to dodge and duck critiques. Yeah. But the problem with that is, right, is like we like political intervention on some things. Mm-hmm. But if you want a system that doesn't have political intervention, I'm not blaming Mr. McCartney, I'm just speaking of Bahamas in general. You're going to have to keep the same energy for everything. Otherwise, what may be appropriate to you may not be appropriate to somebody else, and then like there is no standard for anything. It's just whatever buck up goes. I mean, that's currently how it works right now anyway. But I've been very curious about the situation, and I followed the news on it, but the thing I kept coming up with is like it reminds me of the situation at the University of the Bahamas. For years, the college had tried to raise tuition prices, I think from the late 1980s.
Jesus.
I think it's about 20-something years, almost 30 years, to raise tuition. They eventually did, like 3 years ago. and they couldn't raise prices for things. And it just, of course, when I was a student, I didn't really understand what was going on. And now when you see it from the opposite side of that spectrum, it kind of makes sense. And sometimes political intervention is good, but essentially every other year, I'm sure everybody who was at COB at one point in time can tell you of a story of COBUS marching to Parliament to fight, or Ministry of Education to fight against the raising of the tuition. But the problem is they needed to raise tuition to pay for the things that we need at the university, right? It was not everything as sinister. But again, I understand why it happened, the political intervention. Mm-hmm. It was just the fact that it was almost a 30-year block of that happening, which created a problem. And now we're in a situation where the government's funding majority of it. And then, you know, they've cut down the subvention. Like, this costs too much. And it's like, yeah, we know. So the same situation at BPL. Remember, BPL has $650 million in debt. So when I see things like this and a complete abandonment of the, what was it again?
The hedging?
Yeah, not the hedging. Well, we're supposed to be continuing that. That expires in June of 2022. I don't know what the situation is in the interim. I know that Alfred Sayers had made statements in November of 2020 in reference to him essentially seeking options of extending this hedging. Not at the current rate, probably, but at a new rate, so that the Bahamas could have consistent prices. Yes, right. But again, I not the what the thing that we're charging us $30 a month extra.
Yeah,
with Desmond Bonas again, changing his story on, right? Because first it was to cover the debt, then it was to build a liquid gasification plant, then we can build a whole power plant and then sell it to Shell, and then we can build a whole power plant and then lease it to Shell. And then I was like, I thought Shell was supposed to build the whole thing for free. I was like, no, that ain't happening no more. And then all of a sudden it collapsed. Now, I think we do need not even restructure, we need to get rid of that $650 million balloon over the heads of BPL. I'm actually in support of, I can't remember the word they use, the bond. What's it called?
I don't remember.
The Tina, you remember the name of the bond.
No, I don't. But I know that the BPL situation is funny because, if I remember correctly, they had been in talks on negotiating with Shell to take over certain
plants. Yes, the liquid gasification plant.
But
none of that's happening. But
one of the major debt...
Bond reduction, yes.
One of the major companies that we owe is Shell.
Of course.
So that's why I had a problem. That's a conflict of interest, first and foremost,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's like you go into a bank locally to take out another loan to build your house when you already owe them $40,000 for a car you then crashed 3 years ago.
So they was going to get... I mean, under the original... I hadn't seen the original agreement, but from the talks that was in the newspaper, they was gonna have to give those plants up certain
management of the plants goes. I think ownership of the plants, I think, was to go to Shell, and we would manage, or somewhere along those lines. But Shell would have control. Shell would have
And then and I was like. But first and foremost, I think we need to back up because, like all other things, the mismanagement of BPL has landed us into this position, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, we're railroading back into that direction now.
Well,
because I don't see how the government could. I don't see where the money's coming from to do this, unless we're borrowing for this, which costs money. I'm just saying.
No. But this is why about government intervention. This is why government should intervene, right? But the government has to be efficient, and that's the problem. And competent, right? We have Well, anyway, I already came here on a tip. No, legit. Because, let me tell you, like, I just want to, I really want us to talk about that appointment of Sebastian. We have to talk about that. Because, again, right? Twitter was going off. Like, they was making loan jokes about that, right?
The part I don't understand about that is, well, I have to explain something first.
Okay.
Typically, in the context of countries, usually ambassadors are they're political. It's not always. It's very rare, actually, you get somebody who is trained in the craft of diplomacy or has extensive foreign policy experience gets to be an ambassador. Unless they're an ambassador of certain places. Like, for instance, they're not going to send a rookie ambassador or someone who doesn't have a lot of foreign policy experience in the United States. They're not going to send that person.
Kendall Jones.
Well, no, I wasn't meaning us. Just meaning in different countries.
What is Kendall Jones?
Exactly.
There is a lot of... I'm just saying this. For the most part, though, they tend to just be jobs.
No, but you need competent people. I'm not saying that you have to be... politician.
No, you don't have to be, but I think you should have some background in foreign policy, public policy, something to do with advancing the interests of the Bahamas. And some cases people do.
You need some.
We have some examples, I guess, a permanent representative to the United Nations, some of the team that I know of who are in Brussels at the moment. But most of the positions tend to be shuffled around for political purposes.
In my opinion.
So when government changed, they shuffle people in and out.
In my opinion, some of the permanent secretaries would be a better fit for those positions than the people who they pick in. Mm-hmm. And I'm just saying, right?
I'm not disagreeing.
Like that's just the reality of it. They run these social institutions, and so they know what they're looking for. They know how best to negotiate on behalf because they know what we're actually dealing with. You need people who are invested, right? So if you need to hire someone with a master's degree in policy, like get the people. Like I just don't make sense to me.
This guy's funny. Take this guy's funny.
No, legit. Like why is why do we keep doing this?
Make sense. Supposed to make sense.
So we're going down the same road. So because he's a businessman, what does that mean?
So I think the greatest thing that I dislike about all of this are his supporters. They are the worst. They are sycophants, right?
Yeah.
And we're trying to be critical, like saying, like, why was he chosen for this particular position, or why is he even in government at all? To be honest, but
he didn't have two jobs within the span of 1 year.
Exactly.
I mean, or less than 6 months.
It's only y'all who can't find a job.
Hold on, wait. Meanwhile, back at the ranch. Right? I'm here with 2 degrees. I can't even get what is going on?
I would not advise you to get in government.
You saw what I wrote, right? Be fired. That's just like...
I can do it.
Like, no.
I deal with
bureaucracy.
I've been on many jobs.
No.
In private sector and public, and I can tell you, when you have... You know what? I didn't even go there. It's just not a very healthy environment, depending on which government office you end up in. If you do get involved in government, some places are incredibly competent, shockingly. Tourism seems to be one of the most efficient government issues we have.
It seems like foreign affairs is one as well. No? Okay. By my bad. Okay.
I didn't say that they weren't.
Well, they have some competent people.
Yeah,
I can say that.
Yeah, they do.
Let me tell you why.
I had Vietnam.
Oh, wait. No. The way that Don just looked, he's like, okay. All right. Well, I'm just saying, from the outside in, these are the...
I understand why you say that.
Well, I can tell you. So I knew some people at tourism. So tourism has, at the highest level, tourism has some level of functionality.
Yes.
And that's why we can put on the
productions we do.
No, the pontification that we do on the world stage. Because pontificate.
Yeah.
Because we know how to put on a good show.
Oh, we do.
We know how to do that.
We know how to do that, boy.
Listen, if there's anything we could do, we could look good.
We could cap in front.
Yes. And you get behind them, the scenes.
All the belly come
out. That's when you realize.
All the girl come off.
And see.
The teeth come out.
I need us to catch up. I really need the Bahamas, like in everything that we do. I need us to catch up. If you're going to aesthetically look good, then everything else needs to follow.
I want you. Oh, Lord. the aesthetically look good. Everything else needs.
Yeah, you have to have the substance. You just can't. Yeah,
like you're putting on a bit of a facade of how things actually are. I mean, why am I saying this as if this is something to suggest?
That's not a suggestion. We know that
how it works in the country. The Sabas appointment still, like I probably share you guys, is not really confusion. I understand why we're in this situation. Mm-hmm. Period. I get it, right? But it's kind of, someone texted me and said I should, I want to tie this back into a thing.
Go ahead.
It's kind of difficult to do that.
No, all of this is intersecting, so go ahead.
I'll say this. Sometimes on this show, I find myself privy to information I really should not be privy to. But I can't talk on that part. But I'll say I don't get the Inuit campaign contributions, or there is a intent or purpose. Because even under the Minnis administration, we saw the same thing, right? He was appointed as a resident ambassador to South Africa as well. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not knocking it to say that it's a horrible thing, but I don't understand the justification. But I also don't understand the justification of appointing persons like Wendell Jones. I have nothing personal against Wendell Jones. I just say it.
Again, but my thing is, and we're going to... I really hate doing this, right? Because I feel like we always talk about these very integral things that are going on in the country. And it's like, why do we keep on doing this? It like this is insanity. Like this is delusional at this point, right? It's giving. You know, I don't know. It's giving sociopath. It's giving all of these things. Like it's giving, like needing psychiatric help at this point, right? Because we're literally doing things that go against our best interest.
The Bahamas?
Yes.
That's crazy.
I do not get how we continue to function like this. And when you have people like us having these dialogues, right? And we're trying to, you know, raise the level of consciousness, if you will, right? And all that simply means is we're trying to get y'all to think about these things, right? We're trying to like have these conversations that everybody seems to be running away from and we don't want to talk about. Like people see this as us complaining. And this is not that. This is us literally saying, why are we continuing to do the same things that we have done before or we've seen people do before and not work?
It kind of reminds me of, now we have a special guest too, but it kind of reminds me, I want to bring it. It kind of reminds me of Nigeria when they had all those protests. I think it was, I can't remember the name of the protest.
NSARS?
NSARS and stuff like that, right? Well, they have an issue with Nigerian scammers and stuff. That's a problem, and they admit that. Nigerians will talk about it and say that's a massive problem in the country, but then it's a political reason why it's a problem, because police oftentimes arrest those people and take money from them and then send them back out to go scam more people so they can take money from them. So it comes this power. Bring it up because they've also protested. Nigeria is some of the richest politicians, not in Africa, not in the global south, on earth.
So somebody messaged me and said, I'm sorely wrong about foreign affairs. So, yes.
I didn't want to correct you.
No, somebody said that you were sorely wrong about foreign affairs.
It's. I'll explain on that a little later in the show. I only can speak from my perspective and experience. I don't think they're a horrible government ministry. I just thought certain things were in place at foreign affairs as they would be, as they are currently in Jamaica, in terms of policy. Well spelled out and articulated policy positions on issues like relations with China, relations with the United States. Those things don't exist.
You know where I get sent whenever I ask somebody about foreign policy in the Bahamas?
Yeah.
There's a certain government website.
Oh, yeah, that don't work. That's 2011. It's supposed to have some of the policies posted up.
Exactly.
Yeah, the only articulated policy you can actually really... Well, one of the main ones you can find is the... economic policy of the Bahamas, which is really just an essay on why the Bahamas is a good place to invest in from the Hubert Ingraham administration. But what I was going to say
That's a long time ago.
It is.
That's a very long time ago. It is.
We haven't... 7 as well. So it's nothing really new. It's just an updated version of it.
Then there was a lecture I found one time. I think this guy was a parliamentary secretary under the Pinto administration. He wrote this paper talking about the Bahamas and international politics.
Uh-huh.
And we had a presence then, you know.
Yeah, we had a presence then, but it's different way now.
And I want to go into that later in the show. But before we do, I got to announce our special guest.
Okay.
He's absolutely a friend of the show, a force to be reckoned with. at the University of the Bahamas. Okay. I gotta keep saying it. No, I say that wrong. The University of the Bahamas. It sounds so proper. Like, we don't say cabinet. We say the cabinet.
Cabinet.
The cabinet. It sounds...
Le cabinet.
Le cabinet. You know why I say that? Because they have a WhatsApp group. You they actually do
le
have a...
Le cabinet.
No, oh, it's not actually called that, but I just...
You're privy to that.
No, I have never actually seen it, but okay. I have been made aware that my speculation that exists, it actually does. And I'm sure our guest is well aware of this WhatsApp group. Probably isn't in it, but he's aware that it exists as well. I'd like to introduce our special guest, who's, like I said, a friend, Anna, to Ian Bethel Bennett, who is senior boss man extraordinaire at the University of the Bahamas. Dr. Bethel Bennett, can you hear us?
Good morning, all. Good morning, Nateno.
Why is he so low? Why are you supposed to be excited, Dr. Bethel?
No, hold on. That's how Dr. Bethel Bennett warms up. That's how he warms up. That's how he warms up.
You were throwing me under the big truck.
Because you used to be...
that ended on Tuesday. There's a truck that comes by with all the... I was on...
Wow. Well, you were dean of what is that, a School of Creative Arts and Communication and Creative Arts at the University of the Bahamas. So that's a senior boss man position. You still work in the faculty. Oh, let me shut up. Hold on, my microphone is falling down.
Yeah, he still works. I think he still works. Well, yeah, you still work in the
faculty, buddy.
Faculty, yeah.
Faculty in
the English language department.
Right, right.
Yes.
Now, Dr. Bethel Bennett, you had made a remark, not already a remark, but you'd messaged me and said that we need to actually go back and discuss. We talked about how the university needed to raise tuition, but for a block of time, that wasn't happening. Mm-hmm. And things went awry. Now, maybe, Dr. Bethel Bennett, you have a different perspective on it. You also touched a bit on BC, how we need to also readdress those issues of how BC still has $650 million in debt. I remember that one time we signed on the Petroc rebate, but we didn't sign on the Petroc rebate.
And that's what such thing as free oil, eh?
And the U.S. Embassy said, you know such thing.
That's free oil.
That's cheap oil.
Yeah.
And then the bomb was just like, we never signed on to that. Not flecking us.
Was that during Ingram? Or
that was during the Christie administration. Wow. And that would have been Leslie Miller, who they threw under the bus.
Oh. Yes.
They didn't even try him.
Interesting character.
Yes, he is an absolutely interesting character. Go ahead, Dr. Bethel Bennett.
But you've not mentioned the fact that you are participating in electricity production by a legislated monopoly. You cannot compete with BPL, BEC, whatever you want to call it, Bahamas Electricity Corporation. It was legislated to be the monopoly.
Yeah.
See, the Bahamas had so many challenges in terms of raising fees. The government will destroy the nation, not the state,
to keep the
state running.
Okay.
And successive governments have done that. You know, it's not just one person or one group. The way that the legislation is written hamstrings the functioning of the nation as opposed to the state. I mean, yes, the state workers have a hard time working within the structures, but yeah, the hamstring is real.
Mm-hmm.
And they just play that hamstring. Don, you know that sound very well.
I don't know what you're talking about. No, I know exactly what you're talking about. Again, when you work within the space of whatever government is ever in your life, you, it ain't even hamstrung. It's like, you ever know those dogs where people are too cheap to actually bite a dog collar? So they just put a chain around the dog neck?
Yeah.
That's how it is. And the harder you fight against it, it digs into your flesh and takes more weight. So the only thing you could do is become that chained animal and sit there and then try to rob everybody that walk past you.
That's a very...
The problem with that is that it assumes that you will always be that size. So when you put that metal clothesline around the dog's neck as a puppy, the dog grows. And he will die because it will become infected as it grows into his flesh. Mm-hmm. We have no problem with that. The dog dead. Oh, my.
Yeah. Well, this is a very vivid description that you guys are giving. I will say that. Go ahead.
Well, no, it is absolutely
a... No, it's a very... But I think it's a poignant one. But go ahead, Dr. Bethel Bennett. You were saying something. Sorry.
And we see no involvement in the dog's death. We did nothing wrong. We just put the clothesline around his neck and left him.
Well, yeah. That's the dog fault. That dog shouldn't eat them bone.
But this
well, that's what we think.
But so this is why again when we had the show with Gawain, which I was just listening to yesterday, right? Because you know I just have to listen to what we because I need to make sure that I say what I say, okay. You know I like to go back and listen to what I'm saying so that if I'm wrong, surprised myself, I was like I was very much not surprised at what Gawain said, right? Because again I thought that he was framing that whole his whole idea of from where he sits in his position as being blaming the individual, and that's something that we talk about often, right? That we have to look at the structural issues going on within in society.
You're right, but I think in the case of, I'm just saying, I'm not really playing devil's
advocate. Yeah.
I'm just saying in his case, I get what you're saying. There is a response. There is some degree of responsibility on these institutions, like lending institutions in general. Some being far more responsible than others, clearly. Some having different policies and approaches to how lending should work.
Mm-hmm.
It's similar, but sometimes it can be seen as a little predatory. Sometimes it can be seen as if you don't know, it will take advantage of you. I get that. You're 100% correct. But I think, at least my perspective and understanding of that, was that he didn't say this, so I'm not putting words in his mouth. Mm-hmm. But what I gathered is we're not technically a government institution. Revolutions will do you. But we want you to be aware of why, of how this game works. But, and the government clearly
has the problem,
has no interest in...
Dr. Beth Bennett, what do we call that? We call that neoliberalism.
Yeah.
That's what that is.
Neoliberalism, yeah.
That's what it is, right? And Dr. Beth Bennett, go ahead, sorry.
It takes on a particular resonance or fragrance when it's in a plantocracy.
Yes. The
plantocracy. Well, I like that. The plantocracy. I love that.
No, but I think that I don't think
term.
I was actually looking. So I had been. I was doing some work for someone, right? Freelance work.
Big money.
I know about all of that, right? That was the last year.
Cash.
The money's already gone. Right? That was last year. But it forced me to go back and look at this person named William Johnson, right? Who was a planter from Eleuthera, mm-hmm. right? And I'm suspecting that from what I'm observing and what I'm going to continue to try to dig into is that this was the person who owned the Johnson plantation in Eleuthera, right? Because there were several Johnson in particular. Like, he has a list of slaves, right? Yes. Or enslaved. So I'm going through the list trying to figure out, because when they have children, they'll say that this slave was returned for this person who was the child of this person who was a planter on the island of Eleuthera. And trying to figure out where this person came from, because I was trying to establish some line of genealogy between the person and the said family, right? And I got, from my understanding of it, the genealogy meant that the person who I was looking for was used to be enslaved by William Johnson, but they became free, right? Or after 1834, 1833, you know, when we did that, then we go into the period of apprenticeship, yeah. So,
which is slavery with new names.
Yeah, but it started to take on legs, and that you dive into who these planters are, and honestly, I don't think we've moved away from that plantocracy.
We haven't. We have a plantation economy.
We're still working on, and again, we don't take into account that slavery. The way that it works still within our social institutions to affect us in these very particular ways. And that's what I was trying to bring up again, that when you're dealing with very, very neoliberalist kinds of policies, right, that even when you get a policy, it's neoliberalist in that it gives transnational companies or companies more rights than actual human beings. That's when I have a problem. Because these are entities that you've created.
Well, like the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled, right? Corporations
are now
our people.
And they
have free speech, and the more free speech, aka money, the better. So they need to give money to politicians so they can speak more. They're louder when they. I'm not even joking with you. You can Google this.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God. I know. No, I know.
This has really happened.
Yeah.
The corporation is more important than any natural person.
Yes.
And we see this in the continued practice of this in the Bahamas. But we don't address it because nobody wants to go into the archives. the links back to the same people who talk about, you know, natural law and all of these things are clear. And the way natural law is framed is particularly challenging when you come from a black country or a country made up of predominantly non-white individuals. And your law assumes that you are not human to begin with. So you have no rights. So you have no access to those rights, mm-hmm. and you have no access to justice. Does it make sense now?
Well, Don was asking,
the natural law.
What thing, is not? What yeah, is natural law?
I've heard people use all sorts of arguments with that. We got some text, which I'm going to dig into in a bit. But I don't understand what that means, because the context I've usually heard natural law in is when we had a gender equality referendum. I saw that come up a lot, and people were suggesting that if we vote citizenship, then gay marriage will destroy the Bahamas. And they were saying we have natural law that addresses citizenship and all these things. And I was like, why everybody come up with this natural law thing? What does that even mean?
So natural law is the assumption or the understanding, the ethics and philosophy that humans possess intrinsic values and so are able to reason and govern themselves, but need laws there. So there's a natural law that understands that you're human. So if you're not a human, you don't exist in the natural law.
It also assumes that that we are all equal.
Natural law assumes that everybody is equal, exactly. But if you are not human to begin with, then your participation in natural law is...
I love this humanity conversation, right? This ties right into what I wanted to dig my...
This sounds like Rawls, because I was actually doing some work on Rawls' theory of justice. You know the paper I sent over to you. I was thinking about ways that I could probably spruce it up, right? And I was saying to that as a way to, in particular, he was talking about the veil of ignorance. I don't know if you're familiar with that, right?
We're going to address all this today.
Yeah. So again, from the natural law point of view, you also assume that there's a veil of ignorance. And I was looking at Charles Mills, and he was talking that. That if the veil of ignorance lifts, and you find, because he rewrote his thought experiment. He said if the veil of ignorance lifts, and then you find yourself that you are in a white supremacist society, and you happen to be a black woman. He was talking about an American context, or a Latina woman, or a Native American woman. He was like, what kind of life or quality of life would you have access to? And I was thinking about how to apply that to the Bahamas, right? And so this is very interesting that we're having this conversation about the theory of justice and the way that things work. But I agree with you, is essentially what I'm saying.
Someone texted in the middle of this, and they said, please read this. We love the plantation economy. We praise and exalt and defend it like it is our religion. Y'all should expand on the plantation economy theory and how it can be a problem.
It is our religion.
No, legit, it is.
It is.
Yeah.
And someone, this person also said, oh, the Tino, they coming for you.
Okay.
It said, no, I can't read that part because that's information the public isn't privy to. I will let you read it afterwards. Yes. Read it afterwards. Say, where y'all think y'all is. Foreign affairs and tourism is the same, boo.
Okay.
They slightly better than the rest, but still crappy. All filled with, in, huh?
No.
And many sweethearts...
Are ruling there?
Sweethearts of all sexual persuasion.
So to that caller, I will concede that. So let me tell you why. So I had gone into, I was talking to someone, right, who works in government, and they work in the healthcare field. And they were saying to me that this particular place where they work at, you know, is better than the rest. And I said, baby, it's still, you know, sugar honey iced tea.
Yeah.
You know, I said, even if y'all are the best, it still ain't good enough because it don't meet the people's needs. And so I get that. So I from the outside looking in, it seems as if they have some functionality. Now, I think that people could tell you, that's very generous of me because I don't normally give that, right? And so it just seems as if they know what they, like, and I let me tell you why I also say that, because they have to interact with the international community.
Right.
That's the only time that we actually move, right? Or try to keep up, right? Is when we're being blacklisted or when we need money
and
we have to bring up certain things in order to get the money. And that's why we improve infrastructure.
Yes, you're correct. That's how plantations work. All the development is driven by the metropolitic that's outside of the plantation and directs the plantation on how to operate. Now, that ties right into precisely what's happening in Europe right now. But I want to read this text before I
dig
right into that soundbite that we have. It says, someone says, good morning. My view, the reason this government is appointing so many media personalities is to silence them. And two, when their appointment has ended by a different government, they would be more harsh in their commenting towards that administration, thereby giving the administration that appointed them a free ride. This is just my view. That is...
Well, thank you.
How you build the... That, we already have a system like that. You know, that's already been happening in this country. Not necessarily with certain powerful positions of government. When they get removed, they obviously lambast the administration. That's actually...
Well, historically, if you look at it, it happens with the Commissioner of Police.
Or the Commandant of Defense Force. Who always
the Commandant of Defense Force. Let me tell you, so...
Why are they always on vacation?
But that's it. Here's the thing. So
actually fire them?
Right.
No, but like, why are you on 3 years vacation, Mike? Like, why do we have a Commodore?
You raised this point on Facebook, yes, I think, right?
No one answered. Like, why does that happen? I'm not saying it's a choice shit. I really don't understand.
Yeah.
That's like if you have a general of your army and every general disappears for the entire time they're general of the army. And it's like, and when something happens, they magically show up like, hold on, I'm back. We checked the plane. There wasn't any flight plan, you know? We couldn't dive down there, and those Bahamian citizens that dive for that plane for Mr. Ferguson, that's a problem. We can't allow that. Mm-hmm. That makes us look bad. They just disappear back to vacation. Come on, man.
No, but this is the way that it works. So I was going to tell you...
Is it they don't take vacation the entire career?
When... So,
these fellas love Wig that much?
So when I was studying the 1960s, 1970 era, before we got independence, and this is right around the time that the UBP were getting ready to be defeated by the PLP. And it was so amazing that I can't remember the name of the commissioner of police then, but he had actually gotten the UBP had put him as a tick as a person. And I found that very odd and interesting, right? Because you don't really hear anybody talk about this, a black man running for the UBP on their ticket. That's number one. Number two, because we don't like to talk about that, right? We don't never like to talk about how black people or Afro-Bahamians were complicit in the UBP's domination of the space.
Natini, you bring up a good point, but there are entire communities that are established around their fairness, partiality to the United Bahamian Party.
Yeah.
Who were then disempowered when the Progressive Liberal Party stepped in.
Uh-huh. And so... Sorry. Yeah, but that's the point. The point is that what I saw was that the PL... when Randall Fox, again, and I go back to him and his book, because the book is really good, right? If you read it, like, he minces no words, right? He doesn't hold back for anybody, right? And
you tell him where to transport it and carry it.
Yeah. Nobody does, right? So he says that the death of the union, the trade unions, it comes when the PLP, St. Lyndon, creates his own trade unions. He funnels people.
So he
bribes them, gives them money, and then afterwards he promotes them. Some of them sit in parliament. Some of them sit in these on the committees.
We still do it.
Yeah,
we built that tradition.
So they're building
institutions, Natino.
He's creating
jobs and stimulating the economy. You all fellas can't see the vision.
But that's the cronyism.
Exactly.
That's the cronyism that we've inherited and we've been perpetuating. So all prime ministers do that very same
thing
that they would have criticized St. Lyndon for.
You ever watch, I can't remember the name of the movie, but there's this documentary about gangs in Los Angeles, right? And how they have each, like the Crips and the Bloods, and they have the colors they wear, the dances, the hand signs, the language that they use. That's our political parties. And then if you ain't gang, you ain't going nowhere. So, you can't go in certain neighborhoods in terms of certain positions unless you in a clique or a gang.
So we were talking, me and Don were talking about political patronage this week, right? When you showed me the video.
Greek debt crisis.
The Greek debt crisis, right?
Startlingly similar
to ours.
To Greek.
Yeah.
Greece.
Yeah. And, you know, our old co-host talks about this book, The Dictator's Handbook, right? And when we look at what happened after the election, and they're replacing their people, and there's this, he has to replace people so that, that they can ref- they
because
can
it's a new day.
The mandate of the prime minister.
Because it's a new day. A fresh wind is blowing, sir. It is no longer the people's time.
But what, when you hear that rhetoric, right, what do you all say to that? How do you respond to that?
It is a bunch
of hogwash.
Of caca.
Caca.
What it is like I always say, it's the crip walk. Like when government changes, you got to crip walk your way into your position. And you know them fellas who I don't know what bloods do. I don't know. I don't know. Always a dance. They dance their way out of their position. It is a show. And then when the government changes again, you crip walk out of your position. The next set of fellas dance into their position. Yeah. Oh, women and men. It's not just men who get positions, because you too, Tate, could be a woman and still get several hundred thousand dollar contracts. Ain't
hold on,
possible.
I'm confused. What happened here?
I mean, you don't have to just be a man in order to get contracts. That's what I meant. It's very, they don't really care. Well, I don't know. Let me not say that. Certain places they do. But for the most part, it's very, the opportunity is open to all. But this all ties into something, right? Okay, I talked about this brief thing about Europe. We talked about BPL, the realities of governance in this country and how we're still a plantation economy.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, Dr. Bethel Bennett, I'd spoken to you a little bit about the situation going on between Russia and Ukraine. I know everybody's been seeing the news. I have a completely different take on this.
You think everybody has been seeing the news.
Well, you're right. You've heard something at this point. You had to have heard something.
Are you seeing a clip of the mass media portraying Ukraine as the good guys?
Not even just yes. Yeah, that's a part of it.
Yeah.
But also that's a whole conversation on that. But this notion of there is a difference now in this conflict than any other conflict. Aside from the fact that there's a nuclear power involved in the conflict, aside from the United States, who's always involved in conflict.
Let's not even do that for them.
But
they are very much involved.
Of course, yeah. Of course they're involved. Hands deep in this.
Right? Yeah.
But something I've noticed in the coverage of it, right? Because I look at the way the disasters are covered. I looked how the Bahamas was covered with Hurricane Dorian.
Uh-huh.
A stark difference, Tate. And then Dr. Bennett, you may have noticed this too, is when they had that hurricane late last year in, I think it was Louisiana, and it destroyed all those homes and flooded all those people's places. I looked at the footage of what was happening because at the time, I can't remember where I was at the time, but I remember just looking at it and saying, geez, man, these people have lost everything. Like, it was a terrible thing to watch. But then I looked and I thought about it. I said, stop being emotional and look at this and compare this to the situation in the Bahamas. A lot of the homes that I saw destroyed were literally built out of plywood. Not all the homes, and it doesn't mean people are poor, because you had some rich people who got houses destroyed, middle class houses destroyed, but a lot of the structures were wooden. And I looked and I compared and contrasted the comments on a lot of these posts, whether it be on Twitter, Facebook, or wherever it was on YouTube, and people's responses were, for the most part, their heartfelt apologies to these people, saying, I'm sorry this is happening to you. Where can I go ahead and donate and all these things? And I say, well, people did the same thing to the Bahamas. So I went and looked at the old footage of Hurricane Dorian on YouTube and the comment sections and everything. And I saw virtually the same thing, apart from one difference, one major difference. Latino, can you guess what that is?
What? Was it about race?
That was a part of it, but they didn't say that. They said that these people were poor in the Bahamas, and that's why they built their houses so poorly and shabbily, and that's why they were destroyed. Not everybody said that. But there was a handful. So I went on Facebook, and I started to compare and contrast again. I dug up some old coverage of Hurricane Dorian. I remember that he's a white guy, kind of chubby. And he said, standing in the middle of where the mud would be, he said, when asked by the anchor in the studio, what are things like on the ground there? He said, Abaco smells like the Rwandan genocide. Right? Infamous statement. Hello.
But that, I missed that one.
Well, I missed that one, too.
I missed that. I remember that. I watched that again. I was like, oh, okay. So I looked at the comment section, and I saw the same thing. When they had videos showing a lot of Haitians or black Bahamians, it was, oh, my God, these people are so poor, they can't help themselves. They don't know how to build homes. Not everybody was saying this, mind you. There were a lot of Americans that
were incredibly
supportive.
This is Fox News, though.
It wasn't just Fox News. CNN had the same things. MSNBC had the same things. ABC had the same things. It wasn't just Fox News was doing what people in the comment sections were doing. I was just looking at the reactions. So I compare all of that, right? There is a difference compared to how we're perceived, because we are considered a developing third world nation. and the difference compared to how they perceive Americans. Now, I tie this in because this goes into your conversation you had last week with us about manufacturing consent. Because I went and did a lot of research on this, right? And you were right about what you said. So I watched how the coverage of Ukraine was different from the coverage of the conflict in Iraq. How it was different from the conflict in Yemen, in the Central African Republic, which France just can't seem to stop trifling in for 60 years. Or any of the conflicts going on in the Middle East or Africa in general, or any of the situations going on.
They get no coverage
even in South in South America. How they portrayed this was, this is different in Ukraine, not because of its location next to Russia.
No.
Nothing to do with it.
No.
Purely because it was said. But I have a clip to prove my point. I actually went out and I got this clip of, let's see if our producer
can pull that up. I know what you're talking about, but go ahead.
Madam producer, can you pull up that clip of yes, it's some news reporters saying the things that let you hear them say it. Let's play that clip right now. Oh, she's having a bit of difficulties there. We're going to get that clip up.
So it reminds me of the situation I was looking at. I don't know. I saw it on Twitter. There was a certain publication, and it looked at how they were framing Ukraine to how they were framing the war in Iraq.
Yeah.
So there's certain publication, I don't remember the name, I don't want to call the wrong name, but they were saying that we should feel pitiful for Ukraine and because, you know, Russian aggression. And then there was another cover during the Iraq war, which basically said that, you know, that Iraq was being invaded, but it was more so a justified
war. Now with the Russians.
Okay, hold on, we're gonna play that clip. Sorry about that take. We're gonna play that clip right now. Let's go.
Marching in, it's changed the calculus entirely. Tens of thousands of people have tried to flee the city. There will be many more. People are hiding out in bomb shelters. But this isn't a place, with all due respect, you know, like Iraq or Afghanistan, that has seen conflict raging for decades. You know, this is a relatively civilized, relatively European, I have to choose those, city where you wouldn't expect that or hope that it's going to happen. So it's partly human nature, but they are not in denial.
Me, I'm sorry. It's very emotional for me because I see European people with blue eyes and blonde hair being killed, children being killed every day with Putin's missiles and his helicopters and his rockets.
And so, of course, I understand and respect the emotion. What you are outlining there is this tension between longer-term efforts to apply pressure to Vladimir Putin, such as financial sanctions, and the very immediate military threat which you're experiencing.
Now the unthinkable has happened to them. And this is not a developing third world nation. This is Europe.
This is Europe. This is different. So again, the list goes on from there. And it's not even just English coverage of this.
No.
French coverage is worse. Spanish coverage is just as bad.
Mm-hmm.
I even found some Dutch coverage of this that's horrible. That says, oh, well, we don't expect this. Europe is civilized. This isn't one of those African countries. I was like, I cannot believe what I'm hearing. So it's different. So it's different, like they said, for the reasons that I'm not. Of course, the race discussion has nothing to do with it. That is a component of it and a tool used, like you say, Natino, from the whole argument and set, because now they are worthy victims, right?
I can't remember.
For a cause.
Well, there was this quote I had, and I'm trying to find it, right? But I was reading a book. I think it was. It's either I was reading a book or I was watching the Noam Chomsky's Manufacturing Consent, and he said that certain people make better victims than others.
Mm-hmm.
And
like Afghani women, after the United States started withdrawing, they started talking about the plight of them. I was like, well, you were silent about this for 20 years. Now all of a sudden this is important. But go ahead, Natino.
But so I think that we have to understand, and this is something that Dr. Bethel Bennett talks about a lot when he in the classroom, right? One of the things that you have to look at is you have to look at the way that people are framing these ideas, right? Depending on how it's being framed, like it provides you like a window into looking at this particular situation. When it comes to white bodies, right, and I know that we, like, even though race is different in Europe, right, essentially what happens is that that because the world is a lot of times seen through that American lens, at least from on this side, we tend to put even though they don't use those words, they still operate with that same framework, right? And I think you see it whenever white bodies are being portrayed, they often, there's a sympathy that is elicited from the viewers, right? But the minute you talk about a developing country or you go to Africa, Africa turns into this mysterious jungle that has never been explored before, and therefore there's much danger and suspicion to happen because we don't know what to expect, because after all we have such a rich and high culture that we don't know what to expect, so we have to go into these places armed and ready to civilize the people. Because
have you seen the width of their noses? They suck up all the air. That's probably the way that they think, right?
So
lips, big noses.
This is why the whole conversation needs to be had, right? Because once you start, here's what happens. Those things fade into background, right? Those ideologies or those ideas fade into the background. They become background assumptions upon which people base their lives and other ideologies on.
Yes.
And I think that if people are starting out with that kind of idea of us, just based on the pigmentation of your skin, you cannot expect them to have sympathy for you when you're telling them that they're killing you in mass, whether it's in America, whether it's in the Bahamas.
Have you seen the... So I was going to say one thing. Have you seen the reports from Africans stuck in Ukraine that the Ukrainian government has been asking them to fight?
Yes.
And they were like, y'all ain't gonna let me out the country.
Yes.
Because I'm black. Fight for y'all? There's actually a clip on Twitter.
I didn't watch it.
Laughing and saying, why me fight for you? No. They're going to see me and see black man and shoot me first. No. I fight for you. You don't care about me. And I was like, well, I can't disagree with the man. But Dr. Spetha Bennett, you were saying something.
I was challenging Natino's use of the word assumption. It's not an assumption. Oh, it is an understanding.
Okay.
It is a history of structural tropes that say you are inferior. Because if you go back to natural law understands that we do not exist as humans because only humans participate in natural law. Mm-hmm. Correct?
Yes.
So the understanding is from the beginning, James Anthony Froude talks about the way that civilization protected the blacks who were enslaved by enslaving and colonizing them. That was protection for them. Britain saved them from themselves. Mm-hmm. That was in the 18th century. The 19th century, we see the same thing. Then Césaire comes along and says, nobody colonizes innocently. I use that with one of my classes, and I could not understand why there was such a challenge with comprehending what that statement meant.
It's all of what you guys are saying ties into this whole narrative. And the reason why I brought up Ukraine, I love this discourse, is the same realities, unfortunately, that Ukraine faces, and we talk about the entire global conversation as if they're the big bad wolf and they're terrible. Again, I'm not excusing what's been happening in Ukraine, the invasion. There's a reason why this is happening that's not even being discussed anymore. But this whole thing of spheres of influence, right? Because you know what happens, Tate, when a non-American power comes into the Caribbean and tries to influence the Caribbean? The last 10 years of Bahamian history happen, where there's consistent spats between the Chinese embassy and the U.S. embassy, where President Donald Trump comes in and his charge d'affaires then says that the Bahamas needs to choose sustainable and transparent partners for economic development. Then the Chinese government says America is trying to force the Bahamas to choose who it wants to deal with, and that the Bahamas has the right as a sovereign nation. We keep using this word, sovereign nation, to make its own decisions. But do we? I mentioned before in the show this conversation about BPL and how once upon a time when the Petrocaribe, we were supposed to get cheaper oil and gas from Venezuela, cheaper than we could ever get it on the global market. Because Venezuela was facing some economic challenges from sanctions from America, mm-hmm. right? Due to the whole spat with ExxonMobil and at the time Rex Tillerson, who was in charge of ExxonMobil. I keep bringing this up for a reason. We got the infamous statement, there's no such thing as cheap oil, and then the Bahamas withdrew from that, threw Leslie Mill under the bus, the rest is history. So we come back to this very same moment in the headline of The Guardian yesterday, where it says, the U.S. urges the Bahamas to act against Russia. And I'll read two very important lines of this. This is, and I quote, the United States and our allies are continuing to support and defend their country and their democracy from unprovoked Russian aggression, including through security, economic, and humanitarian assistance, said Daniel DeRusso. I actually met Daniel DeRusso, cool guy. The public affairs officer at the United States Embassy in the Bahamas. He also goes on to say, and I quote, we thank the Bahamas for a strong stance it has taken thus far and continue to encourage the Bahamas to take concrete steps to counter Russia, such as by limiting Russia's access to the Bahamian financial system and restricting the Bahamas' airspace to Russian aircraft. Now, I don't think he had any sinister intent himself, but it kind of does. Right? In the sense that, again, I ain't a supporter of Russia. I ain't a fan of Putin. I ain't getting in the conflict. I have no say in this because we have no power as a small, tiny little nation, right? But I'm just saying, the part about the financial system, which has been under consistent press, that Tate, you talked about blacklists. Mm-hmm. How when big nations want to get small nations like ours right. to do what they want, they blacklist them. They threaten them with sanctions, and we will destroy your economy if you do not comply. We talk about the Monroe Doctrine, right? Mm-hmm. How all the nations in the sphere of the United States needs to do things according to the United States' interest. Otherwise, you're going to get some freedom and democracy, buddy.
Just invaded.
Or we're going to sanction your economy to death, like so, Venezuela. We're going to do a regime change. We all need some new government.
Interesting examples that came up. The UN vote for this week, right?
And yes.
I understand that Zimbabwe had abstained.
Zimbabwe abstained. Of course they can abstain. South Africa also abstained. The representative from the UN for South Africa also said that it's unfortunate what's happening to the Ukrainian people, but the same amount of attention this conflict is getting, all the conflicts around the world need to get and be addressed by the UN Security Council. Mm-hmm. But anyway, continue.
So yeah, and then I think what happened was that Zimbabwe after the vote.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I want to bring us back for a second, and I apologize. It's going to take me a minute to connect the dots.
Go ahead.
Boris is a very interesting man in all of this because his hair moves, but he doesn't. Like, he gets away with. So he can destroy people by having social gatherings that weren't really social gatherings. He can have 30 people in his boardroom. But it wasn't really a gathering. People can get drunk and fall down, but it wasn't really. He can write a story at the beginning of his career that ends his journalistic career that was completely fabricated. So we forget all of these histories that have created the moment that we're in. We forget how a bunch of journalists created a situation where the UK was, you know, really in trouble. This was in, I think, 2010. Wasn't that long ago. But we have Boris, who is sitting in the middle of a bunch of Russian, to use that word, oligarchs that mm-hmm. began divesting British people of land in London in 1991, 1990, somewhere around there. So that when Anna Minton writes what she's writing about in terms of English people not being able to afford to live in London, there is something going on there that we're not discussing.
Yeah.
But we don't see that. Again, same thing in the Bahamas. This begins as soon as the wall comes down, the Russians flee for whatever reason. Nobody connects these dots anymore because in order to do that, you
tag rule. Or have integrity.
But this is Europe.
There are legal implications for all of this. There's the law of equity, or equity, the court of equity, and then there is the law of tort. Had this not happened, this event would not be happening now.
Yeah.
but nobody claims responsibility for what their sanctions do or what their policies did in the Bhopal incident in India, for example, and the Chernobyl incident in Russia.
Yeah.
So there are connectivities that we're just... Boris is there for a reason. Boris has survived, even though he took dogs out of Afghanistan over Afghanis. We don't talk about that. No. You know, it's like the song, we don't talk about Bruno.
Yes. Yes.
Encanto is a wonderful story, but there's so much going on within Encanto that we don't talk about.
Yeah, you and I.
Boris and the other Jack in the Box are very alike.
Yeah.
We don't challenge the way they can spin stories that become...
Are you insinuating, Dr. Beck, that there are no good guys, no heroes in this story we hear called Earth?
You mean heroes of the rapists, of the heroines,
exactly.
And yeah. that charge off on the big white horses? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's kind of interesting because right before this war had happened, he was going through his whole thing with the
COVID regulations.
The COVID regulations and then the scandal. Yes. And when that was happening, I was noticing how he was ramping up his rhetoric on Putin and Russia when Putin wasn't really giving him any air. But now, since this war started, you completely forget about the COVID scandal.
More
you
don't hear anymore.
But also, the other Jack in the Box, who he's talking about, Donald Trump, right? He's taken on this position. Again,
praising Putin.
Not praising Putin. Well, in some cases praising him, and in other cases saying that if it were me in that position, what I do
is cause global nuclear war.
And it's just George Bush saying that he has a sense of his soul. If he has a sense.
No, but but again, so this.
Yes, he did say that. He did say a painting that. Of him.
Yes,
he painted Putin. George W. Bush painted Vladimir Putin back in 2008, I think 2007, 2008, and said. He presented it to Putin as well and said, I looked into his soul right before he invaded Georgia and said that this man is good.
Good.
And
yeah.
Oh, no, Georgia. I remember that. I do. But I don't even know where to go with that. I was going back. because.
Bush is an idiot.
Because, oh, no, God. Because, so I want to go back to the thought trying to get at, right?
Yeah.
From a Bahamian context, is this idea of how easily we forget. Remember, I started when we started talking. I talked about this collective amnesia, or this willful forgetting.
Yeah.
And I was saying, I was trying to bring it back to try to understand. And that's what I've been trying to understand. How is it that these events get erased so easily, right? How is it that me and you remember, right? Me and you remember the raincoat incident with Philip Brave Davis after Hurricane Dorian, that PR nightmare of a stunt, right? That he hopped out. It was tone deaf. It was everything that just didn't need to happen or come.
Hurricane Matthew, right? You pulled up in front of people's homes
in that big truck.
In the big truck with oh my god,
pushing water.
See,
in the house.
But so the issue is then why are we remembering these things? Yeah, or the whistle, the rape whistle. They need to have whistles. How is it that we're remembering these things, but everybody else somehow just collectively forgets this? And I'm really trying to understand, especially for the Bahamian context. I know that we're making connections, and Dr. Bethel Bennett, you're making connections all around the world to bring us back to the Bahamas, because that's what he's doing.
Thing.
Yeah, I know you do that, right? So I get that. But I go straight at the heart of the problem. Why are we trying to, what are we running away from, or what are we actively avoiding?
Let me ask you a question, Atino. This goes a little bit back to the international thing, but ties back to exactly what you're saying. Have you seen the conversations recently about, not even the conversations, 36 countries referred Russia to the International Criminal Court of Justice and are saying that they're wanting to investigate Russia for war crimes. You've seen that, right? You've seen that tape?
No, I haven't seen that one. Okay.
Well, that's what they're trying to do, because Russian leaders is war criminals. Is the problem.
So they're trying to do another Nuremberg?
No. So why don't we just do all American presidents?
See, okay. Now, I like that you brought that update. Here's this collective amnesia.
We need to talk about the drone strikes then.
The ICCJ exists under the Rome Statute in the United Nations.
Mm-hmm.
The United States withdrew from the Rome Statute in 2002. Mm-hmm. You know what they did following that?
Right.
They invaded Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
Russia also withdrew from the Rome Statute in 2016. You know why they did that?
Because they were going to invade.
No, they had already annexed Crimea, and they've been sanctioned for it. And they said, I see where this is going, because he knew what he was doing the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
So he withdrew from it. They have no jurisdiction in the country. But collectively, including Boris Johnson, who's leading this effort, is drumming up this story that they're going to take Russia to court. And I keep saying to myself, I remember when the same thing was threatened against George W. Bush. Mm-hmm. And you know what he did? He fought vehemently to ensure that the ICCJ never gets jurisdiction in the United States. And then President Obama campaigned that he's going to change all these things, close Guantanamo Bay. It was the first thing that man did when he got in office. He also worked to ensure they passed legislation. One of the first pieces of legislation he passed was to ensure that the United States never returns their signature to the Rome Statute. Mm-hmm. And they're still to this day, and he made sure of that, are not a part of the Rome Statute. They have no jurisdiction. You know why? Because he continued and expanded George W. Bush's drone program.
Yeah, the drone program.
So, also notice, the United States is not a part of this coalition of nations reporting Russia. But it is all of their allies that are doing it. Mm-hmm. They know it's not going to go anywhere.
Like, so,
but this is part of this collective amnesia you're talking about.
Don, I have a question
for
you.
Go ahead.
But you guys are so young that you probably weren't born. How is it that Bosnia, Serbia, and all of those
they were different
places that are not very dissimilar from Ukraine can allow the deaths, shall we use the gentle word, of all the men and boys, but not be charged with anything until well after the fact? I was at university with a whole bunch of people who were resettled in France. How do we forget that? How do we not make these connections that this has been going on every 5 or 6 years for the last 40, 50, 60 years?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
In Palestine and Israel.
Yeah,
We shan't talk about that.
Israel is also not a part of the Rome Statute.
No, I hate this because I was having a conversation with somebody.
North China.
And, you know, I hate this narrative that we painted that Israel's supposed to be protected because it's God's nation, it's God's people. And I've seen people hide in the veil.
What did you say, Dr. Bethel-Bennett?
If you look at natural law, Tate...
Yes, they're more human.
Yeah.
They're the most human.
But this is what I've been arguing.
Give him a second.
No, you were going to say something, sorry?
I think you're saying give him a second.
Okay, well, yeah. So this is what I've been arguing, right? That according to the whole idea of natural law, black people don't fit into... Black people are not human.
No, wow.
Black bodies are not human. Even though we've, and this is why you can contest this whole idea of slavery ending. Slavery never ended.
It materialized in a different form.
Yes, it materialized in a different form. It materialized in the 5-day workday.
Well,
it's materialized in the hotels that Ian Strawn calls plantations, neo-plantations.
Also, decisions that we make as a country. Why we vote the way we do in the OAS. For things that really have no interest for the Bahamas. Why are we voting for regime? Why did we vote for regime? We know why. For regime change in Venezuela.
We get stuff
twice.
We get something wrong.
We didn't get
again,
anything.
Because we're lapdogs and we're looking for the crumbs falling off of the table.
Well, I also think, similar to Ukraine, of course it's not the threat of violence against your body. It's the threat of violence against your economy. Why we make the decisions that we make. And that's why I said, in some ways, we talk of spheres of influence and Monroe Doctrine and also the situation with Russia.
So you're saying the structural violence.
When you try to when you try to veer off the plantation a little too far, you'll be shot in the back of the head. And there are different ways they go about doing this. Sometimes they put the shotgun to your knee and say, we're going to blacklist your financial services until your country complies with what we want. Or in, for instances, like we're seeing now with the Russia thing, I understand why the United States is doing this. It is in their interest to do so. Is it in the interest of the Bahamas to do so? Well, it would be in our interest to not get sanctioned, so I guess it's in our interest to do so. So you kind
but
of...
And this is what we were talking about at the end of the last show. Remember, I said that if we are the lapdogs, right? If we come to grips that we are that, we have to also recognize that they need us.
Of course.
And if they need us...
Ukraine is a prime example of this. I need you to not be in NATO. And you won't go join NATO and flirt with them. So now I make the horrible decision of invading your country. I don't think this is going to work out at all well for Russia, but that's another conversation. We got another text. Go we got a few, actually. This one goes back a bit to what we were saying. What Natino said as about us moving for the plantation foreignitized into a plantation economy thing. Also goes in to say journalism doesn't pay. It's too much censorship and other things. Here, they said, also, no, Britain gets a pass because the royal is supposed to be visiting us this week anyway. And it says, they ask the question, is Ukraine a rich first world country? I think that would add to your point about how people are perceived. Avoco is rich compared to Ukraine. The GDP here is higher, and up until Dorian, it was one of the only, if not only, islands to make a surplus at the end of the year. Abaco. The truth is, Ukraine is actually the poorest country in Europe. The GDP per capita is lower than most of the Caribbean. Again, it doesn't take away someone's humanity, but I'm very curious as to why they kept saying that they were rich and prosperous. But it's always about the way things are framed.
It is resource.
I was just gonna say that
wealthy. It is hugely wealthy.
Yes.
So the people, like in the Bahamas, people have been, even though the GDP is so high, that GDP is not shared. We have one of the highest Gini coefficients,
of course,
in the region. But the wealth within the country is huge, and I mean the resources.
I don't think the resources. I think this is my opinion. Now, I would posit that the argument about them being prosperous, all these things are just sideshows to the main event, which is just all of this media coverage we're seeing is just because it is the adversary for the last century almost, finally involved in another conflict, where Western powers are able to, you know, have some power and influence, and we've seen the blitz of sanctions against them as well. And so I think all these questions, concerns, we're talking about manufacturing consent, in order to do the things that it would be seen as necessary to do, essentially to destroy.
You have to manufacture consent.
You need to. Yeah. And you see the coverage of what happens, right, with the defense of the nuclear power plant. And I kept saying, if I know it's a nuclear power plant and I'm being invaded, I'm not going to defend it. Because if I do, they're going to blow it up because my people are going to be in there shooting at them. So I would give up the nuclear power plant to avoid a disaster. But it's deliberately.
Because of whatever they're manufacturing.
Well, and also because the media story. So if you look at every time these things happen, they drum these things up on social media, then the news picks it up, and then it just runs and creates more outrage. And then they're like, see what they're trying to do over there? And then they just expand the net of sanctions. Mm-hmm. Because it's happening right. This is the most perfect example of it. And they're also going to use this as an excuse. As you and your little small country don't want to comply, this what you standing up for? You standing up for somebody who do it. See?
But watch this. So go ahead, sorry.
No, you.
Okay, so I was going to say that I'm glad that we're catching it in the whilst it's happening. Yep. Because too often, I think as Dr. Bethel Bennett was saying, it only happens after the fact.
The post-mortem.
Right? And remember now, this was the same. So when I hear you talking about CCC, this is what they're manufacturing consent because they're thinking, and the U.S. is not in there, I think, for
altruistic means?
No. They're in that deliberately because when they do come on the scene, they're coming on the scene to invade Russia because they want to fight Russia. They want Putin out, right?
They want regime change.
And so they want a regime change. So this could possibly be the smoking signal or the gun for them to say, well, it's time for us to now get rid of him.
I don't think they'll invade, but they're doing it economically. And you saw Lindsey Graham on Twitter also say, call for the assassination of the Russian president, which is absurd to me.
But remember now, that's the same thing they did to Saddam Hussein.
It is.
Remember now, watch this.
It was a crazy mad.
Watch this. So I have to be careful because if you look into Iraq historically, the reason why Saddam Hussein even got into the
yes.
It's because of the United States.
Yeah.
Yep.
See, but they don't want all of. And watch this. It was only when he.
Panama is an example of this too.
Yes.
Noriega.
Yes.
They funded Noriega. The man the entire time.
But Nicaragua. But, yes. El Salvador.
But also
with Pinochet.
Yes.
Yeah.
So all of these things. Even Batista in Cuba before Fidel comes to be.
Right.
That's the reason why Fidel is the way that he was towards the United States, because Batista was horrible, and the United States gave him tanks. They gave him everything he needed. Right, and he's still lost, and so this is this kind of idea that we're gonna use our media, we're gonna manufacture consent, and once we have the public's consent, we're gonna go ahead and do this. And watch this, it will not be looked at as a war crime because it's already been framed in a particular narrative. It's already been framed in a particular kind of way that once you're living in that ideology or that way of seeing the world through the lens of through the American exceptionalist lens. Then you become complicit in the violence.
But okay, take it back.
Okay.
Take it back.
Okay.
Take it back again for a particular reason.
Yes.
And it was harder than to manufacture consent because the media was nascent and there was not a whole, you know, you didn't have a TV in every house. You didn't have printed portfolios flying around. Second World War, totally manufactured. Japan is doing whatever it is doing. All this crap is going on. The Nazis are invading. The right wing is taking over. Things are imploding. We don't care. Like Don was talking about, whiteness is constructed in very interesting ways. Whiteness is normative. Everything else is outside of that norm. So the Italians in the South, well, Mussolini can kill the Italians because, you know, they're not exactly...
Yeah, they're a little olive-colored. A
spicy white.
Those nostrils are a little wide.
Olive white, you know, off-white.
Olives
even in America, Italian-Americans face a lot of discrimination. Yes.
Classism and racism within the European construct. Europe is a new designed entity. It does not exist in reality.
Yeah.
That whole European thing covers over a whole lot of angsts and angers that have harbored and festered for years.
Yes.
So go to the Second World War when Hawaii is bombed. That is the only way that the U.S. is provoked into fun. People know this is going on,
mm-hmm.
but you have now manufactured consent because you pissed people off. When you live in the U.S., and I'm coming back to another point, Don made, the houses that we saw coming up around us, say you're in a town for 6 weeks, a house can almost go up in 6 weeks with the roof, the walls, from the ground up in 6 weeks
mm-hmm.
because of the way they are assembled. So you're almost terrified that if... a hurricane comes through, the house will be leveled. In the Bahamas, it's much harder to build a house like that. But the representation is otherwise. And there is no discussion about how those houses in the United States are built in 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks. But there is a discussion about that happening in the Bahamas.
Yes.
So you're manufacturing all the representative tropes that you are using to control the narrative that is completely dehistoricized and decontextualized.
Yes.
Sorry, that was a big word.
No, that's
it.
No, we got that. Yes. Yeah.
And so that tends, and the reason why I bring all of this up is it allows governments to do the things that they want to do. Tying this back to COVID-19. Remember, COVID is the big demon. And that's why, according to our former prime minister, sometimes the government has to do things that are
unconstitutional. Oh, I will never forget
that. To protect the lives of the people.
I will never forget that statement. Yes.
And notice some of them powers that he put into place to this day have not been rolled back. Right?
Why would you roll them back?
Exactly. If I put in a new tax, remember he campaigned on getting rid of VAT. And then he getting the powers like, get rid of VAT. Get rid of your grommy, but I know a nut. So VAT stayed exactly where it was.
Mm-hmm. So I want to get into the conversation about...
But hold on. Didn't this administration said that that's what they wanted to do again?
No, they're going
to
reduce VAT. But they reduced it, but really raised
before
it.
They were saying though before that well, at least Christie was saying it, that he wanted to repeal it.
He brought it in. 2015?
After he lost.
Oh, but he also wanted to give us free electricity. Mm-hmm. Remember that? You see, y'all got to have... We wouldn't have been in a situation now, Dr. Bethel Bennett. We all have put Chris... You would have free electricity.
But go ahead, sorry.
We ended the show on a very interesting note last week, talking about this idea of resistance and how we're lab dogs, right?
Uh-huh.
And this week, plenty. I saw one interesting statement from the Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines,
okay,
Ralph Gonsalves. And basically, he's an interesting character because I kind of like his outlook on foreign affairs, right? When we would have done the thing with our regime change in the OAS, he kind of lambasted Jamaica and the Bahamas, talking about how he wouldn't go to America to meet President Trump. And this week he put out a statement saying that he didn't want Russia to invade Ukraine because of, you know, it would set off the balance and we're dealing with COVID-19 right now. But he did also talk about how he understands Russia's security concerns as well as how Western nations are, in a sense, engaging in naked hypocrisy.
Yes.
Ooh. So, and he's right about that.
No, he's right.
As wrong as Putin is on a lot of other things, when he said that the West is the empire of lies, I was like, oh, Lord. about hypocrisy.
No, but go ahead.
Why do we see Russians as white? Why do we see Ukrainians as white? What created this whiteness that is so untenable or so sacrosanct, so sacred?
It, like Natino says, it's a constantly changing thing, right? It's always evolving.
Is it the north of Russia? I don't know if they look white.
You can even go to the south.
Chechens, yeah.
The Caucasians and the Caucasus, the Russian Caucasus, the Caucasus Mountains, Siberians.
The Siberians, yes.
Russia is actually an extraordinarily multi-ethnic country, you know. It's not a homogenous group, which is one of the reasons why, in order for Russia to be the big country that it is now, it's always been ruled by repressive autocrats that love to genocide people and put them in gulags every once in a while. That's been the history to maintain that size. But we have some text messages. Someone texted in just like you can at 422-4796.
We haven't had any callers.
We missed them. Okay. So you can also call us in at 323-6232 or 325-4316. I don't know why he does that in this voice. You know. Okay, sorry. Says, adding into the conversation of manufacturing consent, my view is of why people have such short memories is the pressure of capitalism pulling most people's attention to gas prices and food store prices. Following the political landscape, the average person is a gang member in similar aspects to chasing their bread.
Oh, I like that.
We
yes.
also have a caller. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning. I'm enjoying the conversation thoroughly enjoying the conversation. Well,
thank you so much, caller.
Yes.
I'm looking forward to listening to the rest of it after I'm through. I think there's something that we need to look at when it comes to Mr. Putin.
Okay.
Being bullied as a little boy in school, he developed a diminished sense of danger. And that seemed to be a character in the KGB. Now, understand what I'm saying. Whenever you have someone who's been bullied in school and will work his way to be a leader, well, he's going to become a dictator. And, you know, I think the Lord rescued us from a previous leader just recently. Who fit the same description. But what we need to pay attention to more importantly with Mr. Putin is his ties with China and his ties with China having a link to Cuba. Now, I was exposing the fact that he has also a connection and this.
You're breaking up.
Carly, you're breaking up a little bit.
Yes.
The connection between the Marillion, Putin, and is one that we need to pay close attention to.
Okay.
Understand from some sources. Not by looking place, but by another methodology.
Thank you so much. The situation with China is one of the most fascinating I've ever seen in my entire life, because what we are actually witnessing is not the beginning of a third world war. What you're actually witnessing is a great power transition where Russia, with their decision addressing their security concerns, which they don't want NATO on their front doorstep. I can understand why. Same reason why the United States threatened to bomb and invade and eventually nuke Cuba for the Russians putting missiles on Cuba. Let me tell you this now. I had said this as a joke before. If the Bahamas were in a situation financially, which we kind of, some would argue, kind of are approaching there rapidly, we're in debt distress and we need to get out of our situation. I need someone to bail us out. Or we suggested, how about you buy Anagua and put a base down there?
Oh.
And a Chinese major naval base would be less than 300 miles off the coast of Florida. You know what would happen to the Bahamas? If we don't get invaded, we will be sanctioned to death. And you know what? That would then create a situation where we're more subservient to China. But what I'm saying with this case of Russia, Russia economically is essentially imploded. They're going to become a very closed economy, and their ties with China is going to only increase in their cooperation. As a result of that, China is going to grow even bigger as an adversary. But I'm just saying, you may disagree, Dr. Bethel Bennett. 1 second. I'm going to take this call. We're going to address that right after this. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, Dawn. Good morning, T. Good morning, Tino. And good morning to your guests. I hear him a few times on Aaron's show. Yeah, listen, I would like an input, Dawn. I want you guys to listen. I'd like for you, Tino, and everybody to respond, right? But a caller would call. He's always on point. You know, the thing is, delving into the psyche of Vladimir Putin, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was a KGB agent, and so he's a bit older than me. So the thing is, we have to look at the era in which he grew up in and the amount of information he was exposed to. Now, we know that history is always obfuscated and convoluted. There's no, that's a fact. That's aphoristic. Even speaking, people have a problem. At the bottom, there will always be contention, so people will fight you down even in what you say, in ignorance, especially amongst the black people. So, you know, we know that everything and everybody came out of Africa. We know about climate biology and phenotypical changes, right? These are basic facts. Now, with Vladimir, remember now, Ukraine and Russia are linked historically.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So it's like you separating Abaco from Andrus and Nassau, right? So his ideals, you cannot hate. But Putin allegedly started the shooting, right? Yeah. To look at the psyche of the man. So if something circulating on social media, because of my knowledge, I know it's correct. Here's where it's at. He's standing against the New World Order, right? And I know that for sure because when the Illuminati was first implemented, Adam Weishaupt, it was a messenger sending on a horse and they didn't lightning strike him, so the stories is said, and it was exposed, the secret society was exposed, and so they ran to other European countries and Russia. And so Russia was known for persecuting the Illuminati. But the reason for that was they had already found out that the Illuminati had been infiltrated by the Roman papacy or the Catholic Church. And so the origins of the Illuminati was good intentions, learned men, right? Believing in God and sharing skills. Architects, artists, just any professional, mathematics, etc. That's why you see the compass and the instrument there on the emblem.
The Freemasons?
Yes, there's an emblem.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Uh-huh.
There's a mathematical evidence, but it's a compass, something you could use like a compass. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, because they had infiltrated the Illuminati, the reason why, because the Illuminati was not under the papal order. They were deviant from the Roman Catholic Church, similar to Martin Luther, the German reformer. So the Pope infiltrated them and discredited them. So when they went to Russia, this is why Hitler hated them. And this is why Russia hated them. You see? And so they eventually moved west to Europe and west in America. And so the idea is being changed. And then that's where the Luciferian doctrine come in, as anyone who knows about Aleister Crowley, et cetera, et cetera. You see, reading over the years has put me in more like I don't want to express it, but it's just like watching horror movies, and you've been reading for so long, and knowing everything that you've been reading for the past 40 years or more, as you watch it comes through incrementally. And so what most sheep don't realize is, the way how to take over the world is incrementalism. Thanks no more. Because when you read Silent Weapon for Quiet Wars, which they try to dismiss as satire, you would see that it was always an insidious agenda to use technology to control mankind. And so China and Russia don't need the New World Order because they already have control over their people. So notice, you're being observant that you're not hearing anything from India. So even let's juxtapose this. A few weeks ago, a few months ago, India was portraying all of its military weapons and might. China was doing the same. North Korea is doing the same. Russia is doing the same. So I know World War is going to break up. Something got to break up because it's a reason for them showing up these military might. It's a reason for that.
Okay.
All right? And so this is not about 52 trying to be on the radio. People say, well, 52, you need to get a YouTube channel. I just found out that they just cut Louis Farrakhan. So that should scare anybody else because no deviant information can be reached now. So they have drawn everybody to the smartphones by using and out of smartphones, which simply means a device which can send and receive a message. They have the woman private parts, can be hooked up to the internet now to prove fertility, etc. I'm seeing innovative show. Yeah, yes, I'm telling you. So we are moving towards this paradigm.
We're going to cut for a commercial break. You can call us right back.
Yeah, all right.
You can call us back. We got to cut for commercial break. We'll be right back. Dr. Beth Aben, hold on to that. Right back after this.
Find what you love and let it kill you. Sharp under pressure, thinking diamond. All eyes on me like a conductor. That means just play your role, you might get chiming. Wait, play the game to change the game. Word to Gooch, that's my hitter. Your wave is living in the moment, huh? My wave is living for the moment. I know what I'm doing. Yeah, I know what I'm doing.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
How important collecting your money is. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Girl, you see how Cora eye look funny, all black up yesterday?
But she say she bump into a wall when she's running after the churn them.
Yeah, but last Saturday, you see her arm was all black and blue, right?
What you saying? You think something wrong between her and Jack?
I ain't sure, but you know Jack is a jealous man. I hear him and Cora last Friday. I hear him say he hear Cora have eyes for Junior.
Now, you know that ain't true. Cora is a good woman. Does mind her business, take care of them churn, and go to church every Sunday. So what you think we should do?
I think we should report Jack, you know. Cora don't say nothing, but silence hides violence, and we don't want to line up in the cemetery.
Not me. I ain't getting in nobody business. Then Jack come after me and I line up next to Cora.
No, man, we could call her text Crime Stopper. And remember, we can even get some grocery money for our tip.
Remind me again how this work.
We can call them in Miami at 328-TIPS or 328-8477. Or when we in the island, call toll free at 300-TIPS or 300-8477. And if you don't have no minutes, use the Crack Crime Bahamas app and we could text them and the messages get on mix up before it leave your phone. So nobody can know what you're saying.
So what are we waiting on then? Let's go earn some grocery money.
And we're back on the Eye Opener. Thank you for listening. If you're still with us, we still have Dr. Ian Bethel Bennett from the University of the Bahamas with us. Dr. Bethel Bennett, you were going to say something you're going to push back on something Don had said. So go ahead with that thought, and then we'll continue from there.
I didn't want to push back. I wanted to push forward.
Okay.
Oh, he's going to chop me up this now.
It's like, it's when we look at the United States, we tend to look at the United States as this monolithic place, which is a big, big, big mistake. People believe that Donald Trump won the election justifiably because in their neighborhood, in their state, everybody they know
voted
for Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
If you live in Hicksville, South Carolina, everybody in that town will have voted for Trump. So you understand that what you are seeing is normative of what's going on in the entire nation.
Mm.
I hope that makes sense.
Yes.
So Trump has created a particular kind of, or he's given a name to a particular kind of fiction that was already functioning before he came to power, because there were particular players in the former PLP administration who would often talk about parallel facts and et cetera. But when
fake news,
what came to the fore is the way he used language and policy language to develop enemies of the state.
So language is important.
Language is extremely important. So if you note that the former prime minister of the Bahamas used the tools, the same strategies, deploying similar messages as former President Trump did.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. If you go back to manufacturing consent, you have to work almost nothing. Mm-hmm. It's very little effort to manufacture consent when you have an uneducated population. Mm-hmm. And when you have teachers who are teaching students to not think, who are unable to read. So the text is a wonderful place to hide messages because when you teach somebody not to read, you basically create a malleable population. So when we see different texts coming through, like Not on Our Watch, or what was going on with the royal family in Russia and the royal family in Britain,
mm-hmm.
and the fact that these two royal families are closely linked.
Mm-hmm.
Cousins. And the fact that when the king came to the Bahamas, we were closely linked to all of that.
Mm-hmm.
The Bahamas is not just some insignificant backwater. It is here, I want to say, it's here for a geopolitical reason. And we tend to ignore that because we are a small country and our gazing is a wonderful part of our constitutional makeup. But the wider sphere of the royal influences within the creation of divine law, which is one of those natural laws,
mm-hmm.
means that we can't topple them. They are up there next to God. And if you listen to the way Bahamians speak about that, divine law continues to cover the country in everything.
We got a handful of texts. Excellent points, Dr. Bethel Bennett. Someone says, slavery left this white savior impression on us. Look at the way we see and treat white Americans and Europeans, the British royal families, and even Columbus. We love to defend Columbus. He is the white savior of the Bahamas. They're obviously being. They said it's Stockholm Syndrome. We can't imagine why they don't love us. Just like that episode of Fresh Prince where Will Smith was crying when his father left and said, why you don't love me, man? There's another text we got. Someone says, the four main objectives of U.S. foreign policy are the protection of United States and its citizens, the assurance of continuing access to international resources and mission of power in the world, and the protection of its democracy. Fred Mitchell was asked the same question. What is the foreign policy of the Bahamas? Texter, just want to interject here. I also don't know. I tried to find this myself when I was doing my master's, and there was no answer. I thought that there was some articulated policy, but there wasn't. So here's what a texter also posits in this, or they suppose. He said his response was to make it easy for Bahamians to travel to other countries. This is one example of why the Bahamas will always remain a third world country.
I want to challenge the concept there, because we don't ever do it. What Bahamian? What does that mean? What is a Bahamian?
Dr. Bethel Bennett, thank you.
I will tell you what a Bahamian is, Dr. Bethel Bennett.
Thank you for that question.
Is somebody, from my understanding of Bahamians and how we define Bahamian, who gets to be Bahamian? A Bahamian is someone that is probably of darker skin complexion in the eyes of a lot of people. They ain't that rich. They are just slightly above struggling, but sometimes still struggling. Well. It seems to be, because if he's educated, he must be gay.
Yeah.
I'm just being honest.
No, that's for real.
That's it right there. Does that have to be it? No. And that definition also changes depending on where you are in the Bahamas. Because if you go to Spanish Wales, that definition is different. You go to Andros, is different. You go to Nassau, it's way of Putma. So
we haven't done
it. And I think it was Pauline Davis or somebody, I can't remember, who brought it up about the Olympic medals. That when Sir Durwood won his gold medal, he was not a Bahamian. Person.
You're shaking the table.
We have created this narrative that the Bahamas and Bahamians are that came into being in the 1970s, which is when a lot of the capital withdrew from the country. We never connect these dots.
So something interesting that Tino said a few weeks back, and it's kind of ringing in my head again, this idea of what a Bahamian is. You talked about to be Bahamian is to forget, right?
That's what I'm positing in the paper.
So
there
was a discussion about on Twitter on this particular page that is run by a Bahamian of a lighter skin hue who lives on Long Island. And we were having a discussion about what is a Bahamian. Right. Mm-hmm. And we kind of brought up the privilege and the whiteness and how they have a different experience from Black Bahamians, and the experience is different from white Bahamians in Long Island.
Mm-hmm.
And throughout that whole discourse, they were trying to essentially punch down on the race discourse and just basically paint it over with the idea that I'm a mm-hmm. Bahamian. Right?
Uh-huh.
So I think it's starting to make sense to me.
No, but this is I don't know if I talked. I've been working on this. I did a paper, and I've been arguing this with Dr. Naomi Campbell Hall, because I did a paper in her class on trying to really go to the root of this, because I wanted to do at the crux of what Dr. Bethel Ben is asking. You have to have some philosophical underpinning of what this is, because I think that this is why. We can. This is one of the reasons why you can easily skate over these events and not remember them. And so, what I had posited in the paper was, or I was telling Dawn and Tate, I was saying to them that I'm positing that to be Bahamian means to forget the past of what has occurred in this space.
Yes. That's
right?
Part of it, I think.
And Natino, in my work, I'm using something called unremembering. So it's much more active than forgetting, because to forget is, you know, it's easy. Unremembering takes a project.
Misremembering.
I think also you're right.
Misremembering.
There's this also thing in the Bahamas, right? Where we talk about.
Oh, I love this, Dr. Bethel Bennett.
We also manufacture consent a bit in the Bahamas. It's such the strangest thing. It's like, when it's convenient, for most of the time, if you are a wealthy Bahamian, you are not a Bahamian, regardless of your skin color, period. You don't understand the struggle. I'm just saying.
You're right.
If you're a poor,
you're right.
If you're poor and you're struggling all the time, that's Bahamian. Until this conversation comes up about time to get a job. Remember what happened in Abaco in the middle of the pandemic, Natino, or right after Hurricane Dorian, right? Where they talked about importing all those persons from abroad to work at that
Mexico,
property.
Mexico?
Yes. Mexican, well, I didn't want to say it.
Let's be honest.
Yes, it is. You're right.
They imported Mexico. See, because anyway, whatever. They imported persons from Mexico to come in and do construction work.
They imported men from Mexico.
Men, yes, men. And the argument was that Bahamians, lazy. They don't like boycott. They always on their phone. And then all of a sudden, you see Bahamians join in and say, yeah, Bahamians lazy. They don't boycott. They always broke and borrowed money, never just have this. And then it's like, okay, so this is what a Bahamian is. Then the narrative changes again when the COVID-19 comes up. It was Bahamians need help. We're compassionate people. We like to wake up. We don't like to be on hand and feet towards the government. And it reminded me of that thing I showed you, Tate, about Greece. And why I said that I was so shocked at how similar the Greek debt crisis and essentially the meltdown to what it is now is so startlingly similar to the Bahamas is Bahamians. When it comes to government giving them things, we are communists. When it comes to us paying taxes, we are libertarians. When it comes to immigration, dealing with Haitians, we are fascists.
Fascist, yeah.
Loving it. When it comes to the government actually taking action against the United States, you know what we are? We are apologists. Fascist, yeah. You can't do that. The Americans. And then some of them turn around and they turn into these war hawks. And all of a sudden, no, America should bomb me. And then it's like, we are whatever we are, depending on the situation. Because we have no identity at times. I'm saying all the time. But if you are literally a chameleon, depending on this tree you're sticking on, something wrong with that.
So
and also someone texts in and say ahead. White Bahamians have a hard time fitting in. That's a whole different problem because there are rich Bahamians and poor Bahamians, white Bahamians. And then there's a whole thingy with that of how a lot of rich white Bahamians don't associate with poor white Bahamians.
Well,
so yeah. It's like...
So yeah. So Dr. Beth, yeah, we were talking about that. Me and Dr. Beth Bennett, we were having a conversation with a white Bahamian, and we were having a conversation, and then Dr. Beth Bennett was he was trying to expand my idea about whiteness because he was trying to get across to me that he always says to me that whiteness is not a monolith, whiteness,
it isn't,
right? He said you cannot think about it like that, right? He said, and he was telling me in my analysis, make sure that you don't think of it as a monolith, right? But that it's more expansive. And then right there was a white Bahamian talking about how when he goes over to I think he's in school in Italy or something like that, and over there, like amongst white people, they're like, you're not really white, buddy, like you're from the Bahamas, but you're not really white. And he's talking about that experience, and it gave me a new perspective because again, that's where the segregation comes in, right? You don't often, honestly,
he experienced it too. Remember with the conversations about African Americans, so people aren't black.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because they. Well, that's something that's
stupid.
No, but because we're not America's Negro,
of course,
right? And because
those other Negroes, the ones that get a little piece of education and come to the country and try to take over. That's the narrative.
Yes, right. When you look at historically, but I wanted to say
you have those other Negroes who have succeeded, just like Colin Powell.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And
Condoleezza Rice.
Condoleezza Rice. But Colin Powell is Jamaican.
Yes. And I think Condoleezza.
So is Tupac. Tupac's parents.
Some of the greatest African American artists in America are from the Caribbean.
So yes, their parents are Caribbean people. Yeah. Almost all of them. All.
But again, this is why when I had conversations, I had to literally check an African American. It was like, no offense to you, but I don't think that y'all really went through anything. Like, cause we had Jim Crow, we had this and that. And I said
we had Jim Crow, we had this, we had that. Yeah, we continue with our Jim Crow. It just looks different now.
So I said no, but I was saying to him, I was like, do you know who Marcus Garvey is? Do you know who, I said, do you know where Stokely Carmichael is from? Mm-hmm. Do you know where Sidney Poitier is from? Do you know where, I can't remember his name, Claude McKay is from? What are you talking about? I said, we have always been active in the struggle in America. I said, so for you to sit here, I said, you don't know the history, your own history. Like, the Caribbean, people from the Caribbean have been instrumental in the fight that is the African-American struggle in America. And that's something that often gets blurred.
But that's the point, Natino, because again, this goes back to manufacturing consent. Because if now you're no longer considered human because you ain't black, you are in a other category. Now that this space has been formed to ensure... This is, I can't believe I'm saying these words. We have to ensure a future for our children. That's an infamous line from Stormfront, right? That racist website. That's kind of the logic that's been established. Mm-hmm. It's like, you're not included in this group. For instance, when you hear the word Asian, do you think of Indian people? No. You think of Chinese people. Mm-hmm. You think of Korean people. You don't even think of Filipino people.
No, but I think of Filipino.
Most people don't.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Britain has done a wonderful job in separating,
of course,
peoples. So if when you grow up in Britain and you're black British, that could mean many different things. But there are certain things that you can do if you are African British, if you are Caribbean British, if you are Asian, as in East Asian, South Asian. There are jobs that you can do and other jobs that you cannot do. Okay. And that is how insidious that racial division is, even today.
Yeah.
And that troping, the stereotyping, works within those insidious understandings of race.
Mm-hmm.
In the Bahamas, we continue with that. We have no problem with seeing a nurse come from Cuba or from the Philippines.
No.
But you put a black Bahamian in that position and we're going to give them all kinds of grief.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, the strange thing too is that conversation is so deep. We have some text. Someone says, they went in. They said, it's sometimes it can be hard for white Bahamians to fit in. The only place they seem to be acknowledged by society is within their group. I've talked about this before on the show, too. It's not universally the case. How people perceive and treat rich white Bahamians and poor white Bahamians. It is very disturbing. But we don't talk about our race issues in the Bahamas, do we? They said...
We need to get a white Bahamian to talk, maybe talk about that issue.
But exactly. What kind of white Bahamian?
I was just going to say that.
That's another conversation. They say really do need to be acknowledged by within their group. They said, who are bigger Bahamians than Long Islanders who don't even allow Haitians to land on the island because they ain't Bahamian on Long Island for the Bahamas? Actually, the same situation I've been told is present with some attitudes on Manu Marquis. And it was a wealthy white Bahamian that told me that too. Anyway, similarly in Spanish Wells, they always talk about we need more opportunities for Bahamians. We want Bahamians to have opportunities here. So even in Abaco, where they have many foreigners doing boat and dive charters, white Bahamians are always complaining about that. Then you have Bahamian Greeks who think they own the place, and they kind of do.
They really do.
And they said, y'all going fast. So Sidney Poitier was the father of black entertainment in the States. And that's where they ended there.
Well,
so in this book that we are working on,
yes,
that Natino is a part of, that we shall not talk about right now.
Okay,
tell me about this.
Yeah.
The concept of space is explored in many different ways, and one of the challenges is that because the Reinhard Hotel no longer exists, you don't understand that. That is emblematic of something much bigger, much broader, much deeper than today's blackness on Wolf Road.
Yep.
The fact that students cannot read past fifth grade level should say something, but it actually doesn't anymore because it's only the teacher's fault once it's caught.
Yeah.
The teacher that continues to pass this student through the system is not challenged by that system because you're doing what you're supposed to do.
We actually had someone from the Ministry of Education who was used to come on the show, and he had his final episode on the show. He spoke about some research that was done to fix. I will be very broad with this because I don't get him in any problems to fix the education system. I remember the sign of horror on his face when he was coming in here talking to us about it. And it sounded like a great plan, moving the BGCSEs away from these grades and more to percentiles, how the education system needs to be more inclusive with its approaches. His job was to do research on these things for the ministry. And he had come to the realization, or this person had come to the realization, that every time they had brought these things, like was they come on the show and always talk about it, it got put into a filing cabinet and closed for the rest of eternity. And he's last time coming on the show because he had a conversation with management, let's just leave it there, about his talking about these things. And that was the last time he ever came on. But what you're talking about, Dr. Bethel Bennett, is like, the education system problem, and my mother's a teacher too.
Oh, wow.
So I've seen this.
When I was in grade 11.
Private or public?
Public.
Okay.
When I was in government, I was in grade 11 at Queen's College, and she at the time taught at the government high school. And I was sitting in her class for the grade 11 class, and I was just observing the differences between me in grade 11 and them in grade 11. And it was two completely different universes, Tate. It wasn't even like we weren't even in the same country with the level of education. And it wasn't that she wasn't a good teacher or anything. It was the problem is when the students got to her at that stage, they couldn't read and they couldn't do basic arithmetic. So she was teaching them these skills in grade 12 when they were in grade 11.
Yeah.
So the system had failed them long before they got to senior high school.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, and I reference this person who's coming to show, it's not failing because they're dumb. It's failing because the system demands that they fail.
Ooh, I was a GHS on teaching practice, and supposedly afterward, what struck me was that I had the lowest functioning 11th grade. It was an agglomeration of whoever could not succeed. But those kids, if they were not on court that day or in this place the next day or suspended for how much ever time, they were extremely bright.
Yeah.
Now, mind you, they couldn't read and they couldn't write, but they could do all kinds of other things. And I still have some of those. I mean, I'm sure most of them have expired because of the lifestyle that they would have not chosen, but been forced into
or coerced into.
And the part is that we as a society, go back to manufacturing consent, is we have said that these children, dumb. We've said about Haitians in our country that these people ain't supposed to be here. Make up any arguments you want to make up with any group of people. The woman them always making noise, but these rights. When we say these things, and I say this be very careful, even a politician, you have to watch their words, right?
Mm-hmm.
As well as their actions.
Yes.
Watch the lips and the hands. Those things cause the most harm. Once you have gotten to this point where you're okay with doing anything to anyone, when you've put them in this box and removed their humanity, that's when society descends into absolute chaos.
We are there.
We are. And that's the problem I wanted to highlight. It's the same situation you're seeing with Ukraine. It's the same situation the Bahamas is in. There is a gun to the back of this country's head.
Want you to take it right back to Ukraine for one second.
Go ahead.
It's the actor who is now the president. If things go any further south,
which they will,
at some point he will begin to be the representative fall guy for all of this because he lacked sophistication and training. Because this is how the narrative begins to form itself without the real story behind what is going on. And without, yes, it's a land grab. It's an intentional land grab.
Mm-hmm.
But that, the power of language to obfuscate more than to reveal is I keep telling education majors this. As soon as you tell that student he's dumb, he's stupid, that is, you have fed him a line that he will continue or she will continue for the rest of their life.
It'll become a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Hello.
Yeah, I think...
Final words, guys.
Well, I'm going to say this. So I think we need to talk about... We need to dive into the power of language, the use of linguistics, in particular, the way that Bahamian dialect is used here.
Code switching.
Because I think that could give us more insight into our own problems here. Maybe we could get a linguist on. I'll probably talk with Dr. Beth a minute, but one of his colleagues that I have in mind. But I'm going to say what I said to you guys off air. I'm positing in the paper that to be Bahamian means, the more Bahamian you are, the more forgetting you've done, or the more misremembering you've been doing. Because that's the only way that you can claim Bahamianness, right? Because I've often thought of myself, as long as I've lived in this space, I've never felt an attachment to that word. I don't know what that word means to me. I don't feel any relation to it. So when I hear people talking about, I'm proud, too proud, and I'm like, what does that mean, sir? What does that mean, ma'am? And I've come to the conclusion that maybe it means that I'm willing to forget things in order for me to enact a kind of violence upon your body that justifies that, right? Because if I can't remember that exactly the narrative that I've told myself or I believe in, then I could do exactly what I need to do to you, right?
Tate, any final words?
I like the conversation we had about the Bahamas and being in the sphere of the United States. I'm always interested in power. I think I want to take it back to the ending of the show. Like, I really want to have a discussion of what can we do as a nation state to sort of take advantage of the position that we're in. I don't think we're doing a good enough job at that. I think we are, like Latino said, lapdogs of imperialism. But I'm also interested in the conversation of how can we maneuver the space carefully to get what we want as a nation state and to kind of strategize to put ourselves in a better position.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. Good point. Thank you so much, Dr. Bethel Bennett, for coming on the show. It has been, as always, a pleasure. Very rich and deep conversation. We are way out of time.
Thank you for the invitation.
Yes, yes. I got to basically wrap us up and get us out of here. One last text. Someone gave us a definition of natural law. Natural law. Natural law, by definition, is a law of nature, that which is natural. One example is gravity. Okay, sure. They also say, when are people going to be just that, people? There is only one race, the human race. Everything else has to do with skin, color, and ethnicity. Texter, I don't know when that time is ever going to come. I doubt I'll ever live to see it. But I will say this to you, Texter. It takes many engaged behemoths like me and you and Tate to build a much, 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 much better Bahamas. Be absolutely good. Be absolutely great. Go for a jog, you know. Oh, yes. And the thing. And the thing. Hold on. I got to read a thing. I almost forgot. Yes. Also, by the way, we have a new updated lineup on Guardian this week. Yes. So stay tuned for the influencers coming up next, followed by Candid. And then University Drive on Saturdays. You know, Guardian doing some things. We're building some things. Pay attention. Stay tuned. Don't touch that dial. Just play your role. You might get chime in. Wait. That's my head up. Talk about a revolution. There it is. Wait.